Hi, thank you for that introduction. To start, I invite you to think of a time that you, your loved one, or a friend hit their head. Perhaps a small little bump. Maybe they fell or hit their head on a door. Or maybe you know someone who plays a contact sport and they hit their head hard on a ball. A doctor once asked my mom this reflective question, and she immediately said, "No, I have no history of head hits." Then she said, "Oh wait, when I was a kid, I got hit in the head by a baseball." She said she also fell off a horse and fell through a staircase onto concrete. Then she thought of a time that my brother hit his head, resulting in a huge bump on his forehead that was ignored since he was just a baby. My point in asking you this is to invite you to reflect on how often small hits to the head have affected your life, and how these occurrences are often minimized and ignored. In a report to Congress, the CDC referred to traumatic brain injuries, or TBIs, as an invisible epidemic. According to the Journal of Neurosurgery, 69 million people a year across the world sustain a traumatic brain injury. I am one of those individuals. I used to be an avid soccer player. Consequently, I signed a release, as most all soccer players do, that stated I knew the basic signs of a concussion, and I would tell someone if and when I hit my head. I thought a concussion was quite rare, and telling an adult was largely common sense. But when I hit my head, things were not as black and white. When I was in sixth grade, after a mild bullying accident, I was slammed into a steel cabinet at the school I was attending. It's important to me that I bring up that it was a very mild, seemingly insignificant bullying accident, because many kids don't know that these bullying incidents can change a person's life forever, as happened with my life. Now, after I hit my head, everything immediately changed. I have very little memory of the day as a result of post-traumatic amnesia. A few classmates say they thought I was out cold for a few minutes based on the time it took me to get up from the ground. I remember that just prior to my head injury, there were about 30 students in the classroom, and when I had come to, there were about 3. I felt like I was in a war just to walk. I was grasping every desk, every wall I could just to walk a few feet. I tried to walk to my desk, and when I finally sat down, my neck was in screaming pain. It felt like a battle to lift my neck, to look at the clock, to see how much time I had left in passing period just so I could rest. Everything was dizzy and spinning. I was a bit nauseous. I had a physical education class immediately after this, and I felt too sick to participate. So I told the person at the front desk what had transpired. She immediately did the concussion screening. However, I knew the day of the week, who our president was, and my eyes were not dilated. I was told I did not have a concussion and was sent back to class. My next memory is about 4 hours later. I was in the lunchroom and asked one of my friends to walk with me to the trash can. I felt like my feet wouldn't grasp the spinning ground and I was afraid I would fall down. Then an hour later, I remember being in my study hall class and I casually mentioned to a friend of mine that I had hit my head. He jokingly said, "How many fingers am I holding up?" I said 4. He laughed and said 2. Then he held up all 10 of his fingers and I was so confused. It wasn't until that moment I realized I was seeing double. I didn't understand how a human being could have 20 fingers. One of the last memories I have of that day was just a few hours later when I was in the last class of my day, choir. The accident happened during my first of 8 classes of the day. We were doing sight reading that day in choir, so I was unfamiliar with the sheet music. I whispered to my friend, the same person I just mentioned that held up his fingers. I asked him, "Which line of music are we supposed to be reading?" He looked at me, grabbed my hand, and rose it up. I was seeing 2 lines of music, and there was only 1. He knew something was wrong and exhorted me to tell the teacher. Now, I was previously told that I did not have a concussion, so I thought I was fine. Having been a committed soccer player growing up and with the mentality that for almost all injuries, you get back in the field and be a team player, I normally shook off any injuries. However, this time I did not have that choice. My teacher had previously had a concussion, recognized the symptoms I was experiencing, and so she didn't play it down. She told me to call my mom to pick me up and take me to a doctor. My teacher told my mom later that I was slurring my words and stumbling around. When I finally got to the doctor, my doctor said my symptoms were so bad that I probably should have gone straight to a hospital ER. One of my eyes wasn't moving at all, which is why I was seeing double. The doctor ordered me to have a week of doing nothing. I was to sit in a dark room and rest. She gave me a doctor's note excusing me from school for a week. Now for me, this was like a death sentence. I loved school, and the notion of missing school for any period of time was a nightmare. This week for rest turned into a month, and I became diagnosed as post-concussive syndrome. Then a year later, the diagnosis evolved to a mild traumatic brain injury. It wasn't until 2 years after the accident that we learned this incident also caused a spinal cord injury. The symptoms were debilitating. I had about 20 severe stabbing headaches a day, significant immobilizing neck spasms every day, double vision, light sensitivity, dizziness, and more. My symptoms progressed into nerve pain, difficulty walking and weakness, tremors, episodes of amnesia, and then the pressure in my head, and my vision was starting to go blurry and black. This was supposed to be a week-long speed bump in my life, and 5 years later, it has proved to be more than a detour. Now, when you look at me, you might not have guessed that I had a traumatic brain and spinal cord injury, which brings me to the topic of an invisible illness. I generally look normal. I don't have crutches or something that visibly marks me. However, I have constant neck pain. Physical pain is not something that can be easily seen or easily measured. Now, some people that suffer from severe traumatic brain injuries do have noticeable changes. Implications from brain injuries that are noticeable can be devastating. People might look at you differently. And unfortunately, this is made even more detrimental by stereotypes about people with disabilities. We are all unique. We all think differently, act differently, and if we hit our head, the symptoms manifest differently. We are all capable of different things, so generalizing people with disabilities can be hurtful, inaccurate, and unfair. For me and so many others, having a hidden or invisible disability has been a source of incredible pain. People look at me and say, well, at least you look great. They can question your credibility or integrity. People suffering from invisible illnesses are so often ignored, and this leads to ineffective help. A 2002 US Census found that 96% of people with an illness characterized that illness as invisible. Many people with invisible disabilities choose not to disclose it to their employer for fear of retribution. By not disclosing this information, these people are limiting themselves from receiving the necessary and appropriate accommodations that could help them feel supported and enable their success at work. This apprehension to disclose has its root in a fear of judgment, prejudice, and stereotyping. Stereotypes based on disabilities that depict an undesirable image in our society build barriers toward those suffering from these disabilities, seeking help, treatment, and accommodations to succeed. However, it gets even worse. These stereotypes are to a degree prevalent in the medical field as well. The World Health Organization called patient profiling and diagnostic overshadowing a human rights emergency. Routine underutilization of screening and treatment guidelines for patients with mental illness as a result of this profiling has led to countless unnecessary deaths. I personally have experienced this type of discrimination as I sought treatment for my traumatic brain injury. While there are so many incredible doctors that do truly listen and care, there have been quite a few that have disregarded my physical pain. The issue of believability that prevents patients from getting the healthcare they need disproportionately affects women and people of color. We are talking about basic medical care being denied to a large portion of society. Now, outside of prejudice, because mental illness, traumatic brain injuries, and countless other invisible illnesses are hidden from the outside world, there is a significant lack of clear physical treatment. by discounting women suffering from these illnesses as being emotional or people with brain injuries as being lazy. We aren't just hurting the patient, but we are hurting the medical field. We need to pay attention to these illnesses so we can research effective treatments. By encouraging these people to step forward and the medical community to take note, we can maximize our chances to capture data critical toward treatment. We need to do our part to break the boundaries in our society built up by the stereotypes surrounding people with disabilities. Hitting your head on a locker or cabinet might not sound that bad, but sometimes these small injuries, when added up, can be life-changing. As I mentioned earlier, I was very committed to team sports and of the mindset that you need to get back in the game, shake it off, get back in there, help your team. This mindset has been very common. And in light of the football chronic traumatic encephalopathy or CTE stories that are rising, the just get back in there mindset has started to diminish. However, its popularity has shown how in the recent decades, there has been a minimization of head injuries. An example of this is the Supreme Court of Ohio case, Schmitz et al. Versus the NCAA. The plaintiff, representing a Notre Dame football player, Schmitz, and other related cases, argued that due to a football coach's negligence, the players were unaware they had gotten a concussion and consequently got progressively worse. In Schmitz's case, the now deceased football player was playing for Notre Dame when he hit his head. In the case, it is written that Schmitz was neither tested nor examined for concussive symptoms, nor was he advised or educated about concussions while playing football for the Notre Dame. It goes on to say that coaching staff ordered players to continue participating in practices and games following a head impact. After hitting his head, he was sent back into the game and his head injury got progressively worse. While not all head injuries have significant symptomatic effects, this culture minimizes the impacts they do make. A problem with this minimization is that it can shine light away from the issue and prevent innovation. Many people feel that football players are largely protected by helmets, as promoted by the NFL's recent initiative to innovate on the helmet. However, in an Academy of Pediatrics study, they concluded, like many scientists, that the predominant protective gear for football players against concussions, helmets, actually have little to no backing for their effectiveness in decreasing the severity of a concussion. They state that no conceivable helmet will produce a large beneficial effect in this regard. Helmets are designed to protect skulls, not brains. With the recent CTE research published, the effect of head hits is becoming increasingly popular knowledge. However, there is a barrier that needs to be broken. There needs to be an increase in unbiased research in head injury pathology and treatments. As of right now, there is no cure for traumatic brain injuries. The cultural barrier created by the get back in the field mentality needs to be broken. You know, there are remarks people jokingly make when they are annoyed about hitting their head against a desk or a wall. There's even an emoji of someone banging their head against a wall. We live in a culture that has historically turned a blind eye from the issues of brain injuries. The CDC reports that there are approximately 3 million emergency room visits and hospitalizations caused by a traumatic brain injury each year in America. But 5 out of 10 concussions go unreported or undetected. 2 in 10 high school athletes per year who play contact sports will suffer from a concussion. This is a widespread issue, and we need to pay attention and do our part to help by taking it seriously and by being educated about concussions. This brings me to first responder education. It is crucial that people are familiar with ways to respond to a concussion. I don't have enough time to go into the whole process with you here, but I encourage you to go online and find a reference card or research this a bit more. A few key things to keep in mind, though, are that not all concussions manifest the same. So just because an injured person may know what day of the week it is or who the president of the United States is, that does not mean they don't have a concussion. A few key markers to include and look out for, though, are confusion, headache, lack of memory, difficulty concentrating, slurred speech, double vision, dizziness, imbalance, nausea. However, there are many other symptoms that can be observed or reported. it's important to not let the person be unsupervised, because if they are concussed, they might be more confused or dizzy and hit their head again, which can cause severe repercussions. These symptoms may not develop for even 48 hours after the injury. Further, if we disregard concussion symptoms that happen hours after an injury, we may not notice them later. These symptoms of difficulty concentrating or mental fatigue can be present, and months later, people can be left without support, wondering why they're struggling in school or work. 69 million people a year suffer from reported traumatic brain injuries. Brain injuries and invisible injuries are prevalent in our society, and we need to do our part to support those suffering by listening to them, helping them to find care, providing accommodations to enable their success, and working towards improved methods of treatment. Take head hits seriously. Care for people suffering from invisible illnesses. Let's break barriers, not brains. Thank you.